is really connecting a lot of people, and not only here in the Philippines but also in abroad.
They have given us the right mindset, the skill set, and the tool set that we need in order to establish our office and to raise funds for our apostolate in education.
It was very chaotic before spring rain. We were just scrambling and trying to figure things out, where spring rain came and gave us the technology on how to run it properly. We had departments, roles, and it was an organized machine where it's just like a business or any entity that it would function on its own. Even if one person's not there or the president is not there, the foundation is constantly moving and functioning.
For the new PDOs, the resources that you have will be maximized because of the system that Spring Rain will teach you and will share with you.
The system has helped us how to pool resources, how to manage the fund, how also to manage our advocacies, our activities and program, how to sustain it, and plans are being done for its continuity.
I would like to invite you to engage with Spring Rain and help the people, your community, more with the system.
Without the system, it will block succession. If you have the right skillful people without the system, then it cannot sustain long enough. If you have a system without the right people, then you miss the opportunity of maximizing the whole process. There's a lot of donor fatigue that is happening right now. And it's not because they don't want to give. It's about being annoyed by the manner of asking. It's actually the manner of the way we are communicating with the donor.
The perennial problem that we have been encountering is the problem of sustainability. Partly because we haven't nourished and nurtured relationships with our different benefactors all these years. That's when I see the great potential that once we are able to connect and to nurture our relationship with our donors and eventually make their donation, make their giving more of a happy experience, then probably things will be better. So that it doesn't become a linear type of relationship, but it becomes a mutual kind of relationship. When the donor gives, he is happy. He is happy because he was able to give. And of course, he is happy that he is being regularly updated by the happenings and the updates of the foundation itself.
We are able to see more people who are really not only business driven, but deep inside, they want to make their businesses even more meaningful. They are finding meaning on giving impact to the lives of others. It ignites more our desire to do mission, to expand our mission. We are very excited to continue doing it and to be more serious about it.
It takes a way to really study them and learn about how these donors need to get motivated, get involved, so that the fatigue that is happening will turn into a transformation of partnership, love, generosity, and it will create a very wonderful for family in the world of philanthropy.
Thank you. also good morning and good afternoon to those who are joining us from other parts of the world via Facebook Live. Welcome to the ninth day of Spring Rain Global's 45 Days Lenten Recollection, a Lenten journey of faith in the life of the saints. We are live every day for the next days of this Lenten journey via Zoom and on the Facebook page of Spring Rain Global. To ensure the solemnity of our recollection, may I request everyone to please keep their microphones on mute as soon as you log in and for the whole duration of our program. Let us now begin with our opening song followed by the Spring Rain Global prayer.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Spring Rain Global Prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be called in this noble endeavor of serving people and organizations through our thrust for a deeper love for humanity and stewardship of our giftedness. As we respond to this ministry each day, fill us with the power of the Holy Spirit, that your wisdom may enlighten us, that your strength may remind us to stay focused in our purpose and calling, that your light be our guide at all times, and that your love be in our hearts. We know that the journey may not always be easy, but we firmly believe and hold on to your promise that you will be with us both in our challenges and victories as we bring love and unity to your people in service for others. We continue to pray that as we grow the mission and purpose of our Spring Rain Global family, we may be sustained by your grace, ready to open the path for others, so that your blessings and divine providence may completely flow to each and every one of us. May we always stay in your grace, now and forever. This we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We will now play the national anthems of the Philippines, U.S., and Singapore to signify the countries where Spring Rain Global is registered and operating.
Bayang magigil, temas ng silangan, alam ng puso sa dibdib mo'y buhay. Lumang hinirang, tuyan ka ng magiting sa mandulubing. Di ka pasisihin sa dagat at bundok, sa simoy at sa langit mong bukaw. May dilag ang buna at awit sa paglayang minamahal. Ang islap ng matawag mo'y tagong may nananginiling. Ang bituin at araw niya kailan ang may madidiling. Lupa ng araw ng wal, habit magsita, buhay ay langit sa amin mo. Aming higaya na pag may mag-aaki ang mamatay ng dahil sa'yo. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright star through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Or say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave? Mari kita rakyat Singapura sama-sama menuju bahagia. Cita-cita kita yang mulia, berjaya Singapura. Marilah kita bersatu dengan semangat yang baru. Semua kita berseru, majulah Singapura, majulah Singapura. Marilah kita bersatu dengan semangat yang baru. Semua kita berseru, majulah Singapura, majulah Singapura.
Again, welcome to the ninth day of Spring Rain Global's 45 Days Lenten Recollection, a Lenten journey of faith in the life of the saints. Tonight's reflection is about the journey of faith of Saint William Malevan. We will be guided in our reflection by Father Christian Sambahon, CM, PDO Director of San Roque Parish, Subangdaco, PDO, and Assistant Parish Priest of San Roque Parish, Subangdaco. Let us welcome Father Christian.
Hi, good evening.
Evening, Father.
So let me share my PowerPoint. Sandali lang ha. Saan kaya? How do I share screen?
Father, can you see the green ano po? The green button po dun sa baba. It says share screen po.
Oh, hold on ha, hold on. Yeah. maybe I'd like to ask Ms. Clay to simply share my own PowerPoint. I cannot do it in my screen. Okay. So once again, good evening. The saint given to me to guide us in our reflection. In our recollection on the ninth, I guess this is the ninth day of our journey with the saints, is Saint William of Malival. But Saint William Malival is commonly known here in the Philippines as San Guillermo de Malival. With my presentation given to me, I will focus on the life of San Guillermo de Malival as a holy hermit and lover of contemplative prayer. By the way, the picture is portrayed with Saint Malival tied with rope fastened to a tree, and he's looking at the crucifix, and this is one of the oldest known to be one of the oldest paintings, and it's kept in Met Museum in New York, made by Salvatore Rosa in 1661. We will see that along the way, the image that we have been acquainted about Saint Malival or San Guillermo de Malival is a little bit different. Maybe a focus on the life being an hermit rather than as a penitent soldier. Okay, proceed. I have here some pictures of Saint William of Malival. And these are some common images that we have in the Philippines. At first, when I was given the task to present the life of Saint William of Malival, I told Miss Glenda that I haven't heard about him, and I was quite happy with lesser known saints. I can just simply say some things about this person, about this saint of the night. But I was surprised that Saint William Malival is very much known in the north, in fact, dedicated in his honor. These are some images of Saint William Malival. The one in Pasig, that's in Manila, Buting, Pasig, and one in Guillermo Parish in Bacolor, Pampanga, and the other is in the Cathedral of Lawag, Ilocos Norte. Okay. Next. Okay, these are some of the churches dedicated to in honor of Saint William Malibal or San Guillermo de Malibal. By the way, Saint William of Malibal is also known as Saint William the Hermit or Saint William the Great, because perhaps of the great contribution in the church, especially in the early years, in the medieval time, he was known to be the great. So there are also some other Saint William, but we should distinguish Saint William de Malival with those other Saint Williams. So these are some major churches that honor or are dedicated in honor of Saint William. In La Union, Ilocos Norte, Kalinga, Bacolor, Pampanga, Ilocos Sur, Pasig, Batangas, Pasig, Iloilo, and then Cagayan de Oro. So I was mistaken to say that Saint William is lesser known saint. For some, their lives have been revolved around celebrating the memory of Saint William Malibal. And so let us now go into what do we know about Saint William Malibal that would help us reflect more about our faith. Next. Saint William Malibal died on February 10, 1157. So that's the time that the memory of Saint William Malibal is honored, as it is his feast day. So as we said, Saint William is also known as William the Hermit or William Malibal or Guillermo de Malibal. Guillermo is more of a Spanish of William. And there's nothing much written about this saint. We only know some details from his disciples or companions who went with him until the end of his life and formed a community around the rule of Saint William. But they have said that apparently Saint William is born French. He was a Frenchman. And His youth and adult life was spent in an army. During those times, I don't know if still relevant today, soldiers are known with several relationships with women, especially prostitutes. And so as a soldier, has been exposed to this hedonism or the desire of the flesh, and that one day or in some later in his life, he decided to maybe have heard calling in his life, and began going to some shrines. As a pilgrim. And so one of those places that he went to was Rome, visiting the tombs of the popes of Saint Peter, and also he had the chance to meet with Pope Eugenius sometimes in 1140s. And during the time, he made a confession with the Pope, and he pleaded Pope Eugenius III that he would be sent to the Holy Land for a pilgrimage, which the Pope gave him the permission. And for some, they said 3 years. Some others would say that he spent 8 years being a pilgrim at the Holy Land. After his pilgrimage in the Holy Land, he went back to Italy in one province, and then in the desert, he lived there as an hermit, but then later was called to help one monastery and be an administrator of some monks living there. But apparently, Saint William was not successful in bringing some discipline and order in that monastery, so that he withdrew into another deserted place, and then lived an hermit. And then for some times he was not again called, but again he failed in giving some direction to some monasteries, and eventually decided that he would stay in a cave as an hermit and live there in solitude. That place was called Malival. No? In September 1115, and he spent his life until the end doing penance. We say prayer, fasting, and penance. Until the end of his life. Later, he was joined by a companion or a disciple named as Albert in 1156. That's soon before Saint William died. And how did Saint William live? That may be our questions, and that could be the window by which we would also understand his life and also see for ourselves if the life he lived is also meaningful for us. Next slide, please. In the Butler Lives of the Saints, it was mentioned there how this saint lived. The saint, in his discourses with others, always treated himself as the most infamous of criminals and deserving the worst of deaths, and that these were his real sentiments, appeared from that extreme severity which he exercised upon himself. He lay on the bare ground, though he fed on the coarsest fare and drank nothing but water. He was very sparing in the use of each, saying, sensuality was to be feared even in the most ordinary food. Prayer, divine contemplation, and manual labor employed his whole time. It was at his work that he instructed his disciples in his maxims of penance and perfection, which he taught him the most effectually by his own example, though in many respects so much raised above the common that it was fitter to be admired than imitated. We can only imagine William was doing penitential, was an hermit and doing penance the whole life, and that this desire is about wanting to be really in communion with God. And that communion has to have some really discipline. And that what it means that parang sobra yung kanyang ginawa na he doesn't have a bed. He didn't have a bed. And he only would eat or drink when it is necessary. And that he would do all things manually, a manual labor, his whole time. Siguro nakakita naman kayo ng hermit, right? Or in pictures, these are people who seem to be long burdened, and very parang matanda na. And these people are observing some kinds of, they are kind of ascetic people. They would be sparing in consuming food for these are considered pleasure. So there was a turn around in the life of William. In his youth and in his early adult life, he was indulging in flesh, in sensual pleasures. And during those times, the medical sciences is not yet developed, and everything is seen in the eyes of faith, that whatever happens is the will of God, and that sickness are some kind of punishment from God. And when you got sick, or when you are ill, this could be punishment for your sins. And sins sometimes could revolve around mainly about sensual pleasures, or we say sexual pleasures. And that was the life lived by this penitent soldier, William, who turned 180 degrees, persistently pushing himself to know the Lord and imitate him. Okay. Next. Albert, the first disciple or companion of William, was later on joined by Reynold. And together, after Saint William Malival died, they tried to write about his maxims, about his life, and they live their lives according to those maxims, an example of Saint William. And later they created this community of hermits, and they were called Hermits of Saint William, or Guillemites, which eventually were joined to other congregations, and now this group is already extinct. But nonetheless, when Albert died, so they buried Albert in a garden, put a chapel on that garden, and started a new community, live his example, difficult example, but nonetheless was so attractive among young people and some other people, that this life that he lived spread over Europe in countries like Italy, France, Flanders, and Germany. And like Saint William, they also live an ascetic life. Followers went barefoot, and their fast were almost continual. So severe asceticism, or severe penance, the whole time, almost the whole time, consistently, they have been doing it, so that another Pope, Pope Gregory the IX, have to intervene to mitigate their kind of austerities, and give them instead the rule of Saint Benedict about ora et labora. So there is some moderation about everything. But some others also joined the order of Saint Augustine. But eventually some other also went out and regrouped into another group. But the influence of Saint William was so vast during the time that that communities, especially monasteries, have been built in the desire to follow the way of the Lord through the way that was shown example of Saint William Malival. Okay. Pope Innocent III canonized him in 1202. So that's it. Those are the things that we know about the life of Saint William de Malival. It's a short because it's short story, short information, for really there is scarce documents telling about the life of Saint William de Malival. Okay, next. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, there are two areas in the life of Saint William that I wish every one of us, and I invite you to join me in reflecting. Maybe this could be relevant to us, and maybe we could bring this in prayer. Saint William as a holy hermit, and then Saint William as a lover of contemplative prayer. So maybe we have some ideas of what hermits are about from movies or from the words that we heard from other people. Hermit are those with long burden, as we say, and live in the forests. And sometimes we get afraid to talk with them. But mostly hermit are found to be full of wisdom, for they are people who are in communion with the Lord, in communion with environment, and they are in touch with themselves. So they turn their back in the world. Yes, they turn their back, and not really to escape. Maybe the world could be very challenging for them, but this giving up of the world is for them to embrace freely God in their own solitude. And the hermits are sometimes called solitaires. They live alone in their own hermitage. But sometimes hermits live with other hermits, but most of their times, they're only living alone. Have you known an hermit? Or maybe you could ask out yourself, are hermits still around during these times? But I will tell you a story about some hermits that I know. These are holy hermit, especially Saint William Malival. Holy because their intention was to pursue greater relationship with the Lord. No? There was a change of heart from being lover of flesh, lover of sensual pleasures. He turned around and became a lover of God in his prayer and in really studying who really God is, also in communion with the nature. A holy hermit. Okay. This one in the picture is Saint Paul. Saint Paul the hermit, one of the earliest hermits in the church. So next slide, please. The hermit life has long been a tradition associated with seclusion and religious contemplation, away from the distractions of a flawed society. In Christianity, figures such as Saint Paul, the first hermit, embody the idea of a simple, solitary life and imbue a sense of tradition to the religious solitaries that come throughout history. For believers, no one is ever really alone, as they are always with God. That's what we say earlier, that being an hermit is already a kind of life that the church embraced. So it's not really original to Saint William, no? It's not very original. That has been a way for some Christians to be really in communion with God. And indeed, people flee from the world because they know it's already confusing. The world is quite sinful. They have that sense of sin that sometimes we, especially tayo, have not realized. But these people have a deeper sense of sin, sin in their lives, sin in their society, and that their escape from the world is not so much about that they hate the world, but rather there is another way by which to find God, and that is to be somewhere solitary, especially in solitude, no? But in solitude, we say, you are not alone. In solitude, we are with God. We are in the presence of God. And so some hermits stay really in the desert, stay in the cliff, stay in the desert, in the forest, away from many people. No? In communion with God. Okay, next. The Catechism of the Catholic Church says, from the very beginning of the Church, there were men and women who set out to follow Christ with greater liberty and to imitate Him more closely by practicing the evangelical councils. They led lives dedicated to God, each in his own way. Many of them, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, became hermits or founded religious families. These, the Church, by virtue of her authority, gladly accepted and approved. So this is one way of life. If we are used to life in the city, that's one way life, dedicating our lives in our works, making it holy. Some other people live in monasteries. Some other people live as religious. Some other also would live like hermits. And this is very much part of our being church. Next. And it says here, because maybe some other people would be thinking right now, is it possible to live a kind of life like Saint William of Malival and some like those other hermits? In the Code of Canon Law, it says that besides institutes of consecrated life, the Church recognizes the eremitic and anchoretic life by which the Christian faithful devote their life to the praise of God and salvation of the world through a stricter separation from the world, the silence of solitude, and assiduous prayer and penance. So again, separation from the usual world that we know, and living in solitude, in prayer, and in penance, the way Saint William Malival lived. An hermit is recognized in the law as one dedicated to God in a consecrated life. He or she publicly professes the three evangelical counsels, chastity, poverty, and obedience, confirmed by a vow or other sacred bond in the hands of the diocesan bishop, and observes his or her own plan of life under his direction. Okay, so it is a life that is permitted and approved under the authority of a diocesan bishop. So I know one hermitage here in Cebu, and they have been given authority by the Bishop of Cebu. Okay, next. Again, hermits are not really consecrated people, no? Although some consecrated people would live as an hermit. But mainly, they have the same way. They live a life of evangelical councils. Maybe this could be our point for reflection, and I will give us at least 3 minutes to answer this in silence. Saint William turned his back to a life lived in human pleasure and embraced the life of prayer and penance. In our own personal life, what are these objects of desires that keep us or prevents me from choosing God's love freely? Okay, we proceed. Okay, Saint William, as a lover of contemplative prayer. We have heard earlier that Saint William in Malival live a life of penance, but also in his life, he lived a contemplative, a life that is contemplative, a life that is in prayer. No? And so we say, Saint William is a lover of contemplative prayer. Maybe we would ask, what does it mean to live or to be in a contemplative prayer? Next, please. Contemplative prayer, as in the catechesis, in our catechesis, contemplation is a gaze of faith fixed on Jesus. I look at him and he looks at me. There is a relationship. This is what a certain peasant of ours in the time of his holy cure, Cure, used to say while praying before the tabernacle. This focus on Jesus is renunciation of self. So the word is renunciation of self. His gaze purifies our heart. The light of the countenance of Jesus illumines the eyes of our heart and teaches us to see everything in the light of his truth and his compassion for all men. Contemplation also turns its gaze on the mysteries of the life of Christ. Thus, it learns the interior knowledge of our Lord, the more to love him and follow him. Again, the key word here is interior knowledge of our Lord. So it is a deeper sense of communion with the Lord. And some people, spiritual people, would say contemplative prayer as centering prayer. Some Jesuits or those who live an Ignatian spirituality has another way of understanding what contemplative prayer is all about. But what we are talking here is a contemplative prayer in a more classical way. And so this is what Ronald Rollheiser said about what really contemplative prayer is. In a classical way. Okay, next. Contemplation is prayer without images and imagination. That is prayer without the attempt. Prayer without the attempt to concentrate on one's thoughts and feelings on God and holy things. It is a prayer so singular in its intention to be present to God alone, that It refuses everything, even pious thoughts and holy feelings, so as to simply sit in darkness in a deliberate unknowing within which all thoughts, imaginations, and feelings about God are not fostered or entertained, as is true for all other thoughts and feelings. In the words of the cloud of unknowing, it is a simple reaching out directly towards God. Friends, normally when we pray, we imagine things. When we pray, we dialogue with God. Normally, when we pray, we use some apparatuses to help us focus. That's the way we do things. That's how we were told. Lectio Divina, it's about imagining. It's about parang you are reflecting about. But contemplation is more on emptying yourself. Imagine we go back to Saint William. Saint William, he tried to put everything aside. And even in prayer, there is no things that he would like himself to do with. What is important for him is to really know the knowledge of God. It is not entertaining about anything. It is about simply being with God. It doesn't concern about feelings. Either one feels good or one feels bad. Nonetheless, a lover of contemplative prayer would only sit and allow himself to be consumed by that being in God or in his knowledge. So have we experienced being in a contemplative prayer? Some of us may already have some background about contemplative prayer. Maybe the way the Ignatian way. But in this, there are also some religious groups that they are more on centering prayer. And that is very closest to contemplative prayer. That is, we let go of everything. And some say we go off idolatry. We go off the images. We go off the feelings. We just only be there for God. Imagine the way how Saint Malival did it. How Saint William did it. He was a saint because of this so much deep communion with the Lord. Okay, so next. Okay, again for reflection. Let us spare at least 2 minutes to reflect on this challenge, guide for reflection. Saint William lived a full contemplative life and pursued communion with God. In what way have I shown to God that I love him? Have I spent even 15 minutes of my time devoted to him in prayer? Have I reached out in love to him without manipulating him for my favor? Let us go next slide. The past century has seen rises in both disconnection and interconnection. So we have experienced that. Single occupancy households are in during these times. Maybe not only because it's economical, but more so of how we identify with people or how we see the world nowadays. While the internet and communication systems have brought us closer together than ever, there is an inner desire among us, really, to get away from it all. Maybe you have experienced that yourself. Lately, in my own personal life, with Facebook, with Twitter, and then some other social media that I thought that I really enjoyed and I really loved being connected with friends. But lately, I feel I have been suffocated by so much information given. And not only that, I have seen a lot, and maybe that could also be your experience. I have seen a lot, good things and bad things, and pleasurable in the eyes. Many of these things somehow give some pleasure, but at the end, leave me somehow empty. Leave me somehow wondering, what is it that I would like to do? And lately, I have observed when I posted in Facebook some, and people started to reply or comment, I felt that these people seem to be looking at me, and I am just giving away my privacy to them. No? In that I am overly exposing myself to everyone. Before, I love to be seen, but lately there's something in me that I'd like to withdraw, so that one day I decided for myself, I will cut off myself from social media. But I bargained. Shall I cut myself from my connections with friends? What would be the implications of this in my life? And I bargained with myself. I said, yes, okay. It's already suffocating to be in social media and internet. I will delete my Facebook in my cell phones. I still keep Facebook in laptop, in my desktop. But now I somehow experience some relief, some kind of freedom of having not to open oftentimes my screen, my cell phone. And so lately I have seen the report from my cell phone that the decrease, slowly decrease of the time that I have been spending in my cell phone. And I'm quite happy and quite satisfied about what has been decided on. Maybe our question again is, where can I find true peace in this troubled personal and social lives? Just the way Saint William Malival, no? He had really a troubled life. And maybe he was so preoccupied with the sinfulness of the world that he decided to turn his back from the world and live an hermit life. What are these things that will really give us peace and a happy life? Okay, next slide. Okay, this is the story that I would like to tell you about, kanina. I ask you, do you know some hermits? Or have you known an hermit? Is this being an hermit still relevant in our times? But surprisingly, the answer is very much a big yes. I know one community in Sigma Capiz, and it is known as Jesus Caritas Hermitage. So this is in the middle nasa forest, nasa barrio, away from the city, from Capiz City. And there is one audacious, very bold priest who have lived in US for quite some times, serve in US in several parishes. He was so loved and appreciated by many, but at some point in his life, there is something calling him. Maybe he has already answered the Lord by committing himself to a priestly life, but not yet. Solitude is calling him. So that at one time, he decided to come home. He left the U.S., asked his bishop that this is not, God is calling me somewhere. And the bishop has accepted him in Capiz, si Archbishop Advincula during the time. And this priest began some hermitage or some cottages in this place. So quite distant or away from the city and even from the neighbors. He spent his life in silence and in prayers. And I know another hermitage here in Cebu, somewhere in Oslo. One sister from, I guess, in Latin America. And he lived alone in an hermitage in Oslo. Okay, so these places are holy places. Next. Okay. So, that is Father Neil. Father Neil, the one dressed in cassock and in priestly vestments. Hermits nowadays, they say that hermits should have some kind of periodic ministry. They can live in solitary life, but in modern times, these people, especially priests, hermits, are in communion also with other people, especially in the peripheries. And what they do is when they go down and mix with people, they share the good news. And when they go back to their hermitage, they bring with them the story of the people, their sorrow, their joys, their dreams, and their ambitions. So they are alone indeed, but they are deeply in communion with God and with everyone. This is how Father Neil Arce identify or define their own community. Ours is a life of Nazareth with Jesus, which means for us living in a contemplative manner with the people sharing their joys and sorrows and trying to live the gospel values in our lives. the generosity of our brothers and sisters in the periphery enrich our meditation and deepens our understanding of Jesus' hidden life with the people of people at Nazareth. So we say, the life lived by William Malival, San Guillermo de Malival, is a testament to us that when we feel that God calls us to a deeper communion, we may have that courage to pursue. We may have that courage to live the way like any other hermits, living in penance and living in contemplative prayer. I went in this place, and indeed, when I went there, I can sense really the holiness and the sacredness of the place. We may think of hermits in the past to be like parang so foreign, no? So foreign. But maybe these people in their lives only tried to respond to the calling of God, respond to the needs. That when they are assured, when they are convinced about the calling of God, they could turn their back on anything and embrace the Lord, especially in solitude. As we also have mentioned in the life of Saint William de Malival, more that his life is for admiration, not really imitation, no? But because he lived really a very ascetic life, but that later have to be modified by the Pope with their austerity. Maybe in our own lives, maybe at some point, we are also called to be hermits. No? Hermits in our room, maybe. Not maybe the whole time of our lives. But the challenge really, I guess, is that at least we feel that we are in communion with God. Okay. More challenge really is next slide. It is a quotation not really from Saint William Malival, but from more known saint, very more modern saint, that is Saint Teresa of Lisieux. The vocation, that is our vocation, realized by Saint Teresa, is that our vocation is really to love. Hermits are people who love his neighbors, and who love God deeply, especially in prayers. Next. And so we say, we ask for the intercession of Saint William, that we may also have that openness in the calling of God to be in communion with him. Next slide, please. The last slide. San Guillermo de Malival, pray for us. So thank you very much for listening, and may the life of Saint William also inspire us, or have inspired us tonight. So good evening.
Thank you, Father Christian, for guiding us in our reflection tonight. Tonight, we're reminded of the importance of denouncing a life of excess and worldly pleasures in pursuing a deeper relationship with God. Giving up a little of our convenience from temporal things gives more room for the things that are eternal. And as we go along in this spiritual journey, may we spend more time in reflection and contemplation. May we always appreciate and practice the gift of silence. And may we always be reminded that we will never be truly alone, for God is always with us. Thank you, everyone, for joining this evening. To continue our spiritual growth this Lent and beyond, a group chat will be created for all the participants of SRG's 45-day Lenten recollection. Inclusion and participation in this group chat will be voluntary. Before we move on to the closing part of our recollection for tonight, may we please request everybody to please turn on their cameras for our picture taking. Thank you, everyone. Please join us again tomorrow, 8 o'clock p.m. Philippine time, here at Zoom or live via Spring Rain Global's Facebook page for the 10th day of Spring Rain Global's 45 Days Recollection, a Lenten journey of faith in the life of the saints. Tomorrow's topic is a Lenten journey of faith in the life of Saint Josephine Bakita, and we will be guided in our reflection by Father Reynaldo de Guitera, PDO Director of San Pablo Apostol, SPDO Tondo. We hope that you will invite your family and friends together. Let us nurture our faith, love, and devotion to the Lord. As we play our closing song, we bid goodbye to everybody watching from the Philippines, and good day to all those watching from other parts of the world. Thank you so much. See you again tomorrow, and may God bless us all.